In this video, we are going to see about the dynamic loading. So what is dynamic loading? The previous video, what we have seen is, see here, when the process starts from 0 to 1000, then in continuous line, 4000 to 5000, all the lines of this process 1 must be present continuously. Same way the process 2, all the lines, everything must be present for the program to execute. So this is what the restriction previously. So the entire program and all its data of a process, the program and its data of a process must be in physical memory. It must be loaded in the main memory for the process to execute. Thus, the size of the program is limited to the size of the physical memory. So how much memory is there? That much the user has to write. He is not allowed to write more lines because he is restricted with the physical memory. If the physical memory available is only 50 KB, then he can write a program only within 50 KB. He can't write more program, that is more line of code he cannot do. That is the restriction. So obtain better memory utilization, it comes the dynamic loading, but this is not correct. So we go for dynamic loading. So what is dynamic loading? With dynamic loading, a routine is not loaded until it is called. So what do you mean by a routine? Say this is a main program. In this main program, there are some routines. So this is the user program. So main program, some lines are there. Then R1, R2, two routines. Routines is functions. So that after the end, then routine is there. Then routine is there. R2 is there. Now, not only that, many error routines are also there. So imagine this is the program. Now, only the main program is loaded. Okay. So with dynamic loading, it is not necessary that whole program along with its subroutines must be present in the main memory. It is not that. So what we are doing is, when this program is being executed, when at this line only it is called, R1, a call to R1 happens. So at that time only, the information which is present, this routine which is present in the secondary storage, that will be loaded. After it is executed, it will be removed from the memory. So then when R2 is called, this will be loaded, and after that it will be removed. Then the remaining lines of the main program. So it is necessary that only the main program is loaded into the main memory, the program. So to obtain better memory utilization, we go dynamic loading. That is called dynamic loading. With the dynamic loading, a routine is not loaded until it is called. So it is not, only this is loaded. These are all not loaded. These lines are not loaded. So all routines are kept in disk, that is secondary storage, in a relocatable load format. What is relocatable? It will be ready to transfer. When it is loaded, it will be converted into the physical address. So initially the main program is loaded into the, this is only loaded into the memory. When a routine needs to call another routine, let us say this itself is a routine, the calling routine first checks to see. When a routine is called, first this program will check whether R1 is present in the main memory. If it is not present in the main memory only, an access to the secondary storage takes place. So that's what it first to check whether the other routine has been loaded. If not, the relocatable linking loader is called to load the desired routine into memory and to update the program address tables to reflect these changes. Time being, you may not know what is program address table. You will come to know in short while. Time being, you know that when a routine is called, then this will be loaded. At the time only, this will be added, and there is a address table called program address table where this it will be keeping track of sequential execution of this program. So what are all the addresses of the particular process, that also will be stored in this. So better memory utilization. What is the use of this better memory space utilization? Unused routine is never called. Suppose you have some error routine. Imagine some 5 error routines. If the error is done only, the particular routine has to be called, or else it will not be called. So in those cases, it is not necessary that they must be present in the main memory. Instead, the error routines will be present in the secondary storage, and any user, if any error takes place, then only that error routine can be loaded into the main memory and start executing. So useful when large amounts of code are needed to handle infrequently occurring cases. So that's for error routines. No special support from the operating system is required. It is implemented through the program. There is no need for any special support from the operating system. It is left to the user to create his program in modules, so that if he create the programs using with the different modules, only the required module can be loaded into this main memory. And after execution of that module, and if it is no more needed, it can be transferred to the secondary storage, and the one which is needed can be loaded into the primary memory. So in that way, efficiently the routines can be loaded and memory can be utilized. Dynamic linking and shared libraries. Then linking is postponed until the execution time. In the dynamic linking, as I said, linking is postponed until the execution time. Linking is postponed. So during the execution time only linking is done. This mostly happens for the libraries. Small piece of code. So in order to do that, a small piece of code called stub indicates how to locate the appropriate memory resident library routine and how to load the library if the routine is not already present. If it is not present, how it will be loaded. So everything will be, the informations will be there. So operating system need to check if the routine is in the process memory address or not. So it's like similar to this routine, whether this routine is present in the main memory or whether it is present in the secondary storage. Like that for the library routine also it will be done. So stub replaces itself with the address. If it is not there, then that will be loaded from the secondary storage, and the stub replaces itself with the address of the routine and execute the routine. It is nothing but a small piece of code where it leaves some space for loading the library. So that will be loaded, and then the totally it will be relocatable address will be generated. So dynamic linking is particularly, it is mainly useful for libraries. System also known as shared libraries. So for example, there are different versions. If you run a program with the old version, if you downloaded the latest version, imagine you downloaded the latest version of a compiler, then there may be the existing library itself will have a new version, but you have written a program with the old library, still it works because the new versions support the old library. But what happens when you are executing with the latest version and you are trying to execute it in a older version, then conflicts occurs. So system also known as shared libraries, the new versions uses the old version. That is what we call as shared libraries. The new versions still are able to run the old library. For example, conio.h, if it is the latest version, some other features may be included, but still it supports the old version also. But if you have run in the new version, some of the new features of the conio you have handled, and if you try to execute it in the old version, then the error occurs. So in that case, it must be able to link to the new version that will be loaded. So a library may be replaced by a new version, and all programs that reference the library will automatically use the new version. Only programs that are compiled with new library versions are affected by any incompatible change incorporated in it. Other programs linked before the new library was installed will continue using the older library, and this is called the shared library. It still uses the old library and executes. So this is called the shared library.